Hello world, it is Thursday at noon. This is WHPK 88.5, so you are here with AirGo Radio trying to find some beauty in this sad, sad world.
I'm Kiss, this is Damon. We're very excited to be back on the radio. We got the whole team back in place.
Yeah, man. I'm back in business.
How was the beach?
Sandy.
Sandy. Did you get sand in your food? That's what my problem with the beach is.
No, I ate my food far away. But yo, y'all, empanadas is my move. That's all I got to say.
All right, if you have empanadas, you can send them up to the studio Thursdays at noon. We will gladly accept them. As you know, or maybe you don't know, what we do here, Strong Young Voices from Chicago and beyond, different artists, writers, organizers, activists, poets, cool people doing amazing things, reshaping the culture of our city for the more equitable and the better and the more creative. And we have a very special guest here this week. But first, we got a couple things we want to do.
Yeah, we always do community announcements. So first, I know Party Noir is happening this Saturday. You know of anything else
going on? Yeah, so on that Party Noir line, so they're hosting the show Friday night, actually, at the Promontory also, which is King, which is going to be great. First night I ever worked up there was a King show, and they're a wonderful group. And then, yeah, come through Saturday. I will be working that as well. I'll be at the front door, so come by, say hi, and let me take your money when I give you a ticket. Also, AirGo alum Ricky Gamboa's show Space Age opens on Monday at Free Street Theater. So make sure you can find that on Facebook. Check that out. Or he doesn't really tweet, so just check his Facebook. That was all I had on the community announcements.
Yeah, and so, you know, this is we're about community here. So, you know, in the national community, that was another horrible tragedy that has become public spectacle. And many of us now have seen the death and execution of Alton Sterling. So we just wanted to, one, let you know that we love you out there and that life is precious. And two, I hope we implore that, like, this can be a continuing of, like, an eye-opening experience, and that we don't just stop at the pain and anger of, like, the tragedy of destruction of human life, but also look at our world and our society and how we all collectively, like, participate in a system that allows people to be destroyed and killed in the street for doing nothing, and what power we can take to make a better world. So we want to just, you know, take a few moments and have a moment of silence for the loss, because there have been many police killings this week and many others who have died to violence in this country. So we're going to take a moment of silence and play a little Nina Simone.
So this is for Alton Sterling, Philando Castile in Minnesota. And I also I've been thinking a lot the past week. There's been all these, you know, bombings and attacks outside of this country, and I think it's important to connect those dots too. For the pain and the loss, a moment.
And all that have died on the south side of Chicago.
Broken windows and empty hallways, a pale dead moon in a sky streaked with gray. Human kindness is overflowing, and I think it's gonna rain today. Scarecrows dressed in the latest styles, with frozen faces to keep love away. Human kindness is overflowing, and I think it's gonna rain today. lonely. Lonely. Tin can at my feet, I think I'll kick it down the street. Tin can at my feet, I think I'll kick it down the street. Why not? That's a way to treat a friend. Right before me, the signs implore me, help the needy and show them the way.
Welcome back to AirGo here on WHPK, AirGoRadio.com. That was Nina Simone with I Think It's Gonna Rain Today. We've played it before on the show, but it stays being on days like this, the music that I turn to. So since we get to be on the radio, I figured we'd share it. Anyway, we, as always, have a very special guest here in the studio. Dave, you want to do an intro? I'm going to put you on the spot here.
Oh, man, I'm excited. Just... you know, I like to do like non-bio intros. So like just a...
as seen on Comic View.
But just like one of the, in the city of Chicago, like one of the sweetest spirits and like greatest energies and most positive people. And also like a very reckless dancer as seen in Grinnell, Iowa on the road. Oh, I'm super excited to have them here. Everybody make some noise. We have you off of Pidgeon. Also, like, the coolest name.
Yeah.
How you feeling? How's the world treating you? How are you treating it on this day?
I woke up just thinking about stuff, like the police stuff that's been going on. And actually, Rick Wilson, my best friend, he's always at my house in the mornings now, and it kind of scared me the first few days because I don't... he's like Roger. I tell him go home a lot, but he's always there. But I'm used to it now, so
he
I knew
a very Roger-esque thing about him.
So like I'm used to him being there, but every night I go to bed and I read another shooting, about another shooting, or I see another Facebook... now this is new, a Facebook Live video, and I'm always wondering like, how is Rick gonna be doing? And I woke up and Rick was bringing joy to Twitter about Serena Williams whooping some white girl's butt on the court today. And he's going through my kitchen like, she did it in 48 minutes and she didn't even break a sweat. And he's like impersonating her. So that's kind of how I am, just bouncing back and forth between the anger and the sadness and then like the joy that people in Chicago and this community that we're all a part of are constantly lifting up, which I think is so important.
Yeah. I mean, to that point, it's part of why, and we'll get into, you know, everything you do in a second, but it's one of the reasons why I think I'm really glad to have you be the person who's here on the show, because I think of you as having like the warmest smile in the city that I know, you know?
Didn't you tell Rach Jackson that?
No. She has the, I told her she has the second warmest smile. Shout out to Rach. Uh-oh. Oh man, AirGo guest.
Maybe
I said
Rach.
I think I said like brightest smile.
Oh, okay, Rach. Okay.
Yours is the warmest. And it is, there's a subtle difference there. Thank you for calling me out though and keeping me accountable on my compliments.
I'm not even sure.
No, but I do think like this is when it's good to, you know, have the folks to turn to for that smile, you know? And so I'm just really happy to have you here. And two, you know, to kind of jump into, you know, who you are and what you do, I've been thinking a lot about, like, the terms that we all use and, like, the words that we take for granted that everyone has a shared understanding of what they mean, mm-hmm. and how often we don't all speak, like, we're not saying the same thing when we say the same words. And I know we've had a lot of people who identify as activists up here, and I know that that rings true for you. For you, what, how do you define that term and what you do?
I honestly, I think because of, I mean, I was diagnosed with ADD recently, past few years, but I honestly don't think I have ADD. So anyways, I think because of that, though, if I do have any elements of ADD, I don't like to do just one thing. And I was thinking, like, in the shower today, how I've never done just one thing. And I think that comes from my family. They're never, like, just doing one thing. And so I do a little bit of activism for intersex, and I do it in different ways, whether it's, like, making T-shirts that kind of flip a narrative, or art, or I'm giving interviews, or doing online, like, social media campaigns, or, like, future actions and actions. Or, and I also do, like, photography for Rick Wilson. Like, that's, yeah. like, you know, so I'm always doing different things. And, I write for a blog now called Everyday Feminism. And I walk my dog, and I do wedding photography sometimes. Like, I can't just do one thing. So I think that's all part of my activism, because if I did, I would burn out way quicker if I only did some of that, all the activism only. Because, yeah. like, it's just too much out there.
For sure.
Yeah, yeah. I don't even have a question, because I just was, like, relating to that feeling.
Right.
One, doing too much, and two, that, like, that burnout fear and that, like, that heaviness or that too much. But I want to, like, you gave us a lot of information. I kind of want to dig in.
Oh,
so,
sure.
So you say, you know, a lot of your work comes through intersex. So I would love for us to just, you know, get some background on what that means and kind of tell the people who have not encountered it.
For sure. So I was born intersex, which is a biological variation in human beings that happens in 1 in 2,000 births. On the high end of the spectrum, and some say as low as 0.5%, 0.05% of the human population to 1.7%. And that boils down to about the amount of redheads that are naturally born. Mm. And that just gives you a little bit of the occurrence. And what it means is people who are born, like me, with a variation between male and female sex traits. And those sex traits can go between your reproductive organs on the inside, so your testes or ovaries or uterus or whatever else you guys have inside of you, I'm not sure. and then there's the external sex traits, so the genitalia that we most often think of associated with intersex people or just whatever. And then there's, like, the third thing, which is your chromosomes, the things you can't see. So there's just people that are intersex have non-typical male or female sex traits. And that's really all it boils down to. And it's 90% of the time not health related. There's no emergencies medical wise. It's what's been said as a social emergency, and the people around us when we're born, they kind of can't understand us. And through ignorance and fear and somewhat hatred, they rush in and force our parents to do these surgeries that are quote unquote corrective mm-hmm. to make our bodies fit into either male or female. Mm-hmm. Sex trait categories, thinking that it's going to help us in the long run. That's at least what they say. But they end up being very damaging to people's, not just their bodies, but their souls and their minds and their well-being too.
Yeah.
I'm very curious to, like, learn when that came from experience to, like, work or active public mm-hmm. work, because I would love to hear your perspective on, as, like, kind of just like the mainstream population is starting to have a increase in consciousness around gender mm-hmm. and people are starting to understand more of, like, non-binary identities and lifestyle, especially as, like, the trans conversation is becoming part of, like, the mainstream discourse now, how that has changed mm-hmm. your outreach, at least.
Yeah, it's helped a lot. And it also is confusing sometimes, because mm-hmm. I think people...
Because it's definitely a new element. It's even outside of that box that is, like, supposed to be stretching the box.
It is. Yeah. It is. And it's also, it's like this whole, it's like, whoa, wait, I just got my mind around trans, or I just got my mind around certain gender elements. Like, and now you're trying to tell me sex is not on a binary as well? Like, okay, I could kind of get the gender thing, but the sex? No, like, telling me, like, you're tripping. And I'm like, no, it's real. Like,
trust me on this.
Right. Trust me. I got a whole history of medical records I could show you. So I think it really helps. But at the same time, I think it's our job as intersex activists and people, and then my friends, to spread the message that it's also different. And we have a whole set of different elements that are inherent to our bodies, but also to our struggles. So our struggle, say for trans folks, they struggle to get surgery sometimes, gender-affirming surgeries. Mm-hmm. In the past and still today, you have to jump through these hoops and say you're mentally unfit, or not mentally unfit, gender dysphoria syndrome. You have to be labeled with a disease from the DSM-5, I forgot what that stands for. And then for intersex people, our fight is to not have those surgeries, right. Which is interesting because if you go back to the 50s when this doctor named John Money from Johns Hopkins in Baltimore.
Sorry, his name is John Money?
Yeah.
Is he evil?
Yes, he
okay.
is.
He sounds like
he looked like Mr. Monopoly, correct?
He did. Yeah, you can look him up on YouTube. He's very like cold-hearted, cold-faced.
We're going to tweet a picture right now. I'm not joking.
You could, okay. So, so John Money out of Baltimore and the Johns Hopkins, actually from New Zealand, but studied there, said these intersex kids cannot grow up with a gender that does not match their genitalia. That is just uncalled for. It is traumatic for them. So we must intervene and do these surgeries to match their genitals with their gender that I assigned to them. And so these surgeries went very quiet in the 50s and 60s and 70s. Not many people knew about them because they told the parents, move out of town, change your kid's name, delete their picture, not delete them back then, throw the pictures away, wow. Burn them, change their names from the baby books or like scratch it out. I know people that have seen their names whited out, their original birth certificates and stuff, and then their other name put on there because the doctor said this is the best course of action, and no one in this country generally questions doctors. Mm. Just like a lot of people, especially white people, don't like to question the police or the judicial system. So anyways, they took that for granted back then. And moving to the 90s, things are starting to change. These kids have grown up and they have a voice. They're adults, right, and they're saying what you did to me was wrong. And then you tie this to the trans struggle. They're trying to fight for those same surgeries that were actually engineered and crafted for our bodies back in the 50s. Wow. And that's true. Like you should be able to desire those surgeries and get them if you want, but you also should not be able to have to have them forced upon you as an infant or as a young child, which is even almost worse sometimes because you remember the surgeries more. So that was, I don't know how I got there. You said something about experience.
I mean, that was just the context. I mean, I'm learning. So,
right.
So
that's just you were talking about how it's expanding.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's just really, dense. Because as I'm thinking about it, I guess the two like curiosities I have is first, what, now that I'm learning more of the distinction of the two struggles, where are the solidarities, mm-hmm. or the intersections? Because if it's kind of the same landscape that you're fighting on from different ends of, for lack of a better word, spectrum. like how does that?
Use
that word.
How does
that align?
Everyone take a drink when we hear the word spectrum today.
The AirGo drinking game.
Yes.
Like, how does that align and how does that break apart? And then also what I'm hearing and learning is that a lot of the fight sounds to be in the medical field, in the way that a lot of fights against institutional racism is in the judicial or you know, in the courts.
Yeah.
So I also want to hear a little bit about like the social aspect and the day to day, like the personal life, and not just like the history of the doctors and
true.
Of the policies. And, you know,
yeah. I mean, to that point, I think like you mentioned all those different kinds of activism up top. I think one of them is just like, I know you've done it a bunch, but telling your story, and you know, you kind of got part of the way there, but can you just
my story,
to give
yeah.
that kind of personal to, yeah. That was not a sentence. I just
that was cute. It was cute. So I was born over here in Chicago on a bunch of different streets, but I mostly grew up on Austin and like Austin and Diversity intersection. Mm-hmm. And then we bounced back and forth, and then I went to Elmwood Park, which is like next to Oak Park and next to the city. And then I moved out of Elmwood Park again, back to Chicago when I went to school for college. Actually, funny story, no one in my family went to college, so I Googled Chicago University when I was in high school. And this school came up, University of Chicago, because mm-hmm. it's in the
right.
title.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay. So I went here, my first tour of a school. And my mom drove me. I remember going down Lake Street, and I was like taking pictures of the train above me. And I had a little Sony point and shoot, I remember. And we go on tour here, and these kids are like, I have a 36. I don't know if I could get in. I have an ACT 36. And they're like, I'm like, 36, that's like the top I think you can get. And then they're like, we shut down the football team here to focus on education. I'm like, what the fuck?
What is this place?
And, and I was like, oh, I'm obviously not getting into this school. So anyways, that was, it was interesting. My first time, yeah. My first college perception was this, and it looks like an Ivy League school, and it's exactly what I thought college was like. And
I think that they grew Ivy here specifically so that people would think it, like the everything is covered with physical ivy.
Yeah, I was asking for direction, like by the ivy. They're like, yeah, by the ivy. And I was like, oh wait, that's everywhere. So anyways, I grew up in Chicago, and I think what's interesting is that I grew up with a lot of internalized self-hatred that came without even knowing that I was intersex, but I could kind of tell that everyone around me had something wrong with my body, meaning like the doctors, and then like mostly the doctors, right? Because I had to go to the doctor all the time, and they had to pull down my pants all the time and lift up my shirt all the time and touch me in really weird places that little kids shouldn't be touched by doctors. Mm. And I think without them even telling me I was intersex, they lied to me, by the way. Yeah, they do this lie to kids that are intersex a lot, and they say, you were born with cancer. So my story was that I was born with ovarian cancer, and so I grew up thinking I was a cancer survivor. So I told every year in school, like, what's one good thing about you? And I was like, I was born with cancer. I survived. I'm a miracle. Oh, and that's really like what I thought, because that's what my family told me.
They were telling you that you were had cancer as a baby.
And they saved my life.
Why they removed
my ovaries, which I wasn't even born with ovaries. I later found out when I was 18. I was born with internal testes that didn't descend. They were whatever. And they took them out to make me line up with their gender that they put on me, which was female. I forgot to say that. They assigned me female at birth. So I had to get all these checkups because they wanted to follow up on their first. They did two surgeries on me before I was four in Chicago at Chicago Memorial, Children's Memorial Hospital, which is now Lurie Children's, whatever. And the first surgery was to remove those testes, and the which I was before I was the age of one. And the second surgery was a clitorectomy, which is what a lot of white feminists like to talk about in other countries. Female genital mutilation. They like to bring it down on these countries and certain cultures and say, that's bad, you shouldn't do that, let's do a campaign here but against that. But they don't talk about the intersex genital mutilation that happens in this country every day and abroad, everywhere. So they got rid of my clitoris when I was about 4 years old. And so I grew up with a nightmare of that surgery, but I didn't know it was real. The nightmare was that I woke up with gauze in between my legs, and there was like blood in there, but I just thought it was a bad dream my whole life. And so I grew up going to these doctor's appointments, but I'm still just like a kid. I thought I survived cancer. I'm just a girl with cancer, and I can't have kids.
Did they tell your parents that you had cancer too?
They told my parents that I could have got cancer if they didn't remove my internal test. Well, they didn't say testes. They said something else. They use they say gonads, mm-hmm. Which is neither ovary. It's like what our tissue is before it's ovarian or testicular. All babies have this in the womb. They have gonads. They said your kid's gonna die by the time they turn 16 if we don't do the surgery. So then they told them, but tell your kid she did have cancer and we saved her life. So yeah. So it's I grew like up with a lot of lies.
Yeah. Like come up with that.
Like, yeah. And so. And I, like, was a very religious person growing up. I grew up going to this church on the northwest side called St. Nicholas. And the Virgin Mary there, the icon, cried as during my baptism. And so I always grew up with that story. And then she cried again. And I actually saw it when I was older. And I was like, man, like, I was very connected to her, her weeping, her tears, her sadness. And then, like, this idea that I was born with cancer and that, like, the baptism happened right around that surgery. So I believed it all. And I thought, like, I believed in miracles at the time. I really thought like they saved my life, and I was really indebted to these doctors. And so then I hit 11, and this is like puberty age. I'm in fifth grade. We're going through sex ed, and I realized I'm not going to puberty like the rest of the kids. And I kind of knew that because I always knew I wouldn't have a period or kids because I was quote unquote born with cancer, and they took out my ovaries. That was the whole story to explain that. And I start going to the doctor, and they start giving me pills. They're like, take these pills. And the pills made my breasts grow and, like, other feminine appearances come out. And also they're like, we're going to do a little surgery on you.
And so those were hormone pills?
Hormones, yeah, female hormones, estrogens. And that's what's made me go through puberty because they took out my organs, my testes, that would have let me go through puberty naturally. And they're like, oh, we're going to do this little surgery. And the surgery was a whole nightmare. I woke up from thinking I was having a bladder surgery, which is what they told me, two, I found out when I was 18, looking at my medical records, they did a whole vaginoplasty, a whole nother thing with the clitoris. I don't even know to this day what they did because there's so much medical language in it, and people have tried to describe it to me, like translate it from the medical language to our language. But it's still hard for me to wrap my head around that they actually did that to me, and they do this to intersex kids all the time. So like I said, that's the overlap, is like those vaginoplasty is something that a trans person or anybody might want, but it's something I never asked for, and I was only 11. So I go through high school, blah, 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 go through college, and then I hit college, and I'm sitting in a class, a psychology of women class, and she starts talking about intersex people with my particular condition, which is AIS, androgen insensitivity syndrome. I actually have partial androgen insensitivity syndrome, which is more complicated. But the bell starts ringing in my head. I'm like, that person on the slide that my teacher's talking about sounds like me, but I do not have XY chromosomes. I am a girl. Mm-hmm. I have a boyfriend. I am straight, and I am a woman. Like, this is not me, though. But I don't have a period like this person. Blah, blah, blah. A bunch of things sound similar to me. And I found out that week that I did, that was me. And I got my medical records from the hospital, which was across the street from my college. I ended up going to DePaul, which was across the street from Children's Memorial. Mm. And I got my medical records. And the first thing I read was male pseudohermaphrodite and 46XY, which is the chromosomes. And my world just kind of like sunk. And
wow.
I was like, holy shit, like, this is crazy.
And so what, how was home life during
this time?
Yeah, or growing up as you like had this revelation?
Well, I wasn't at home. I was in college. I was at DePaul, living at DePaul down the street. I mean, my family, we grew up off of Fullerton. So I was on the other end of Fullerton at DePaul, and they were at the other end of Fullerton.
It's a long ride on the 74.
It is. That 74 is horrible.
Forever.
Especially by DePaul. Yeah, it's like a lot of traffic.
Yeah, it's Armageddon over there.
God.
By the Burger King and all. Yeah.
Armitage again, would you say?
Oh.
What did he say?
Armitage again?
What's Armitage
again? He's doing a pun of Armitage.
Oh, get it. Oh, okay.
If it needs explanation.
We're off the rails.
Armitage is worse. Okay. So. You know, the thing is I don't know what is with me, but I grew up very angry. I was a very angry child.
That's interesting.
Yeah, because you guys mentioned my smile. Yeah, and I'm oh my God, I didn't know I had a good.
I want to stop you right there. Do you still identify as angry? Because I don't think
I am. And this is actually something I want to bring up, is that I have a memory of Daniel. I get in tiffs a lot. I get in little squabbles with usually straight cis men at bars. And straight white men usually. And I was at a bar recently after a show at the Metro. I like peeked my head in or something. And some guy and I were about to get into it. I don't remember about what. And Daniel kind of came and mediated. And then it just like calmed down. And then I remember that because I get in fights a lot. Because I'm an angry, I go from 0 to 100 really quick. And no Drake pun.
Yeah.
And I know, right? I saw your eyes.
I let it ride. I let it ride.
I'm only allowed one pun per episode, and I already used it, and I was really regretting that. Real quick to that point, yeah. I appreciate that. You had de-escalated it,
and
you had left.
Okay.
You were on your way out, and I just wanted to clarify.
I just remember that was very nice of you, because that's one of those memories that stuck with me. Mm. And I do still identify as angry. I'm very angry. I'm a very angry person, and I'm okay with that, because I feel like very bad things were done to me, and I think very bad things happen in the world every day, and it's okay that I'm angry. I just have to be aware of it and figure out how to channel that the right way. Sometimes I don't, but a lot of times I do, and that's okay.
Yeah, I want to stick on that because I think that's like exactly what righteous anger is, like what I've been thinking about all day, and then figuring out, like, I don't know, I think like I was really happy today waking up the same feeling, very similar to how you described, to know that I was going to be able to come here and have this show, right? So like knowing that the work was here made me feel better.
Mm-hmm.
And I kept seeing today and yesterday a lot of folks who I admire a lot saying, you know, this will, you know, motivate me to double down and go back into the work harder and all that stuff. And then also people saying the opposite, saying I need to step back. And both reactions are valid. Mm-hmm. But I know for me, my impulse is always to like dive into the work and try to translate it there. But I don't know if that, and this, I don't have like a big, I just have a question. I don't know if that's like the healthiest or most, like healing thing for me all the time, but I do know it's my first instinct. Does that ring true for y'all to like try to turn that anger and that pain into whether it's art or stuff, other kinds of work?
I think what I relate to Pidgeon, where I am kind of feeling in the world right now is I feel responsible to a lot of people. And so it's both motivating and kind of heavy. So like when these things happen, it's like really sad and frustrating, but I feel somewhat like, oh, now, you know, people are looking for something to do. People are looking for, I don't know, some assurance or a group to look towards. And I feel like we are a part of like those people. And so it makes me have to go like really deep internally and stop thinking about myself and stop thinking about my depression, right? And like think about like, I don't know, we got to figure some shit out. Like the world is burning almost literally. Yeah. So that's kind of for me. And then kind of like what you were saying about like you thought about Rick when you heard about this instead of thinking about yourself. I kind of like super relate to that.
Yeah, like I couldn't sleep the other night when I first heard about, I'm going to say the name of Alton Sterling. And Rick was picking up his car. I had his car. It was like midnight. And I was just like, I thought I'd be asleep. But then I couldn't sleep because I just started reading about all this stuff at like 10 p.m. And all I wanted to do was like, I was like, are you up? Like, what are you doing? I wanted to like hug him, but also just be up. And like, I couldn't sleep that night. And but I think there's that binary you were talking about, like either throw yourself in harder or like step away. And I think all of us probably actually just do something more in between where we do both like all day and every day to kind of survive. And or we do just straight up pull away sometimes, which I think is totally valid. Yeah, but I think
I hide a lot.
Yeah.
I definitely hide a lot.
Yeah. I know. Sometimes I see people a lot and sometimes I don't. And that's either because I'm hiding or other people are hiding,
right? Yeah. But to what you said about like that feeling of responsibility and being like, I can't go too far in right now to deal with what I'm feeling because all these people are looking to me.
Not people looking to me, but looking for something, you know?
But I want to challenge you on that a little bit and just say one of the things you can show or lead as is being like, I'm letting myself work through that stuff. I don't know, for me, I can't, it's all one and the same, right? Like going further inward, there's a difference between like distracting yourself and tuning out and going inward. Inward is like actually like, I think the opposite of tuning out. You know, it's like, let me actually engage. The same way like when you engage, right, to what's happening inside me.
And tuning in with what's going on in the world too.
Yeah, and so I just want to like encourage, at least for me, that's very helpful is like, that's part of the work too.
True.
Yeah, and that's not pulling away.
True. Self-care is very important.
Yeah, so for you, since what does that look like?
Oh my God, I don't know. I do know. Okay, I'm actually writing an article right now for Everyday Feminism called 10 or something, some amount of number yet. I don't know yet. Tips and low cost and free tips. Yeah, it's always a list on my website. 10 free or low cost tips for being intersex and surviving or getting by. And one of those things I'm sharing is like I do free yoga on YouTube. I mean, I just find a person on YouTube and I do yoga in my living room. And that's really helped me this year. There's free therapy options sometimes, like through Howard Brown, which is a clinic here in Chicago for LGBTQIA plus people. They have a lot of free therapy. Chicago Women's Health Center has free therapy. A lot of places have free therapy. And I think that's something I do. Not right now because my therapist actually left the profession recently and told me he had to step back. He literally was like, wow. I need to step back. Yeah. I'm so sorry. I'm leaving the whole city, the profession, everything. But that was real. I'm like, damn. That's real.
That's the space that's been helpful for me. That's something that's been helpful for you. Yeah,
it has, and it's been whole super hard too. Sometimes, like after those free therapists end, sometimes you only get 10 sessions or something because of a grant that this place has. And on the 9th session, they'll be like, "I just want to let you know, this is our 9th session. We will only have one more." I literally left. I got up and I just left and started crying and I walked away. I left the whole building and then I showed up on the 10th session. I'm like, okay, I'm coming for the last one because I felt abandoned again. And I was just like, sometimes therapy could be great and sometimes it could be horrible. But
I think that's actually a great way to connect it to like all of what we're talking about all these different kinds of violence, right? Is like the same way that, you know, we've talked about like health centers and mental health centers getting closed across the city and schools being, is like, that's a direct result of that. That's the personal violence coupled with the institutional violence trying to like you're using that institutional space to try to work through some pain partly that comes from other
hospital institutional violence. From the medical industrial
complex.
Then
they like pull the rug out. They like pulled the rug out from under you again. Yeah.
Right.
So that's messed up.
Oh my God. And it's like, I wouldn't. So, oh my God. They created the medical industrial complex. let's just say the hospitals, created this issue in my body that I didn't have. I was born with an intersex body that was non-binary in its sex, in its chromosomes, in its expression. That's natural. That's how people have been born since the beginning of time. That's why there are statues that are hermaphrodites. Maybe not, but it could be. But like, intersex people have been around forever. There's books that intersex people have written. There's diaries from the 1500s, the 1600s, 1700s. It's in the Bible as eunuchs. It's in every culture. It goes back.
It's a human thing. It's a part of humanity. Human
thing. It's also, I think, in the cosmos. Like, the cosmos is not a binary. There's not just like a dark sky and a bright sky. There's always the sun rising, which has a gradation of colors from dark to bright. You know what I'm saying? Ooh. Like, there are no binaries in the world. I saw Def C yesterday, and someone was like, oh, this is Def C. And I was like, and I'm Pidgeon, I got bars. And because everyone's like, Def C's got bars. And I'm like, actually, I got bars.
You got Rick Wilson in the studio. He throws some snaps.
But like, so anyways, the medical industrial complex has created this condition in a generation, in all intersex people, right? They go in, they take our organs out, they take our body parts off, they give us scar tissue, they do these horrible things to us. And then I grow up, I don't have health insurance. My family, we had, Medicaid. And then when I grew up, I didn't or something. And then my grandma one day was like, I bought you health insurance for 1 year. And I was like 16. And I tried to go to a doctor and they're like, oh, you're denied on everything for having a pre-existing condition. My pre-existing condition was only created because these doctors went into me as a kid and took out my shit. Wow. So then I needed these pills that I couldn't afford because they said it was a pre-existing condition, so I had to pay out of pocket. And one day these pills, which I could have been producing my hormones on my own, but I couldn't. One day these pills, I remember this was only 2 years ago, I was going to Howard Brown, which was giving me a nice discount. So it was like $27 a bottle because I didn't have insurance. And overnight, my pills were $260, the same pills, because of something happened in the federal level where they changed the classification of these pills that had a little bit of testosterone in them. And they were like, oh, now, blah, blah, blah. And so I couldn't get my hormones again, which doesn't just affect my sex drive or stuff like that. It also affects your bone density. So I already have osteopenia because of them taking out my organs. And then something with the hormones and especially estrogens play into your bone density and your bone strength. So I've had osteopenia for like 10 years now. And like you were saying, that's a perfect thing. And I'm like, that's why I'm saying, what I'm saying is like intersex people need justice. They need liberation. Mm-hmm. They need a cease to these surgeries that are non-consensual, and they need some type of reparation fund from these hospitals that have done the surgeries and are still doing the surgeries today. There's going to be 5 surgeries today that are done on intersex infants, clitorectomies on them on average. Wow. And they need to pull the money from these hospitals and say, here, kids and adults who are intersex who maybe can't afford therapy or can't afford your pills today or whatever because we did this to you, here's the money, pull from this fund. And I think that's so logical.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. It's like what you're saying is I think is really profound. And I don't want to like get too philosophical on the FM airways. What up, 88.5? This is AirGo Radio, WHPK. But you know, as I'm hearing what you're saying, like what your personal narrative is that like your body is like a microcosm of the bullshit that's like happening throughout the society.
Hell yeah.
Right. And like your experience and your anger is like what pushes you into being active. And then what you just said was that like the struggle or the problem that's been forced upon you was like created and man-made. Right. And that's kind of like the same for the entire system, right? The entire structure. Right. Like even when we think about criminal justice. Right. Like nobody besides the police or the system has the ability to create a criminal. Right. Their poverty is created through like capitalism and like the production of good, like the production of goods
and the hoarding of
creates the scarcity of goods for people who need it and like necessities. And so it's just really interesting.
And the invention of whiteness and the fragility of it.
Right. Is to destroy other people, right? Like the idea of like we need to create this ideal life is based on like destroying so
it's
much
based
other
on myths
life.
And destruction and violence. And they know that. And that's
maintaining
why
power.
And maintaining power. And that's why the police are here. Trying to maintain that power because it's so fragile. Whiteness is so fragile. And the same with the sex binary. It's so fragile. And the sex binary just doesn't exist on its own. The sex binary exists and the gender binary exists to keep power in one group of people, which is traditionally white men, white, cis, Christian, able-bodied men, but men in general. And me, as an intersex infant, I think at least growing up, this is what I was thinking, I threatened that binary. I threatened that doctor's perception of his masculinity and whatever. And they did these surgeries to kind of make me sure I fit back in that place, that rightful place to keep that binary. You threatened
the position of what a woman and a man is, right? Which is like how so many goods and like power is distributed based off.
So it seems like now you, well, let me ask you this question. Do you take joy in being that threat to that fragile power structure?
Your shirt says too cute to be binary.
Yeah.
So are you?
There's the warmest smile in China.
I do. And this is a little story. There's a white man on my block who called me a cunt recently.
Oh, wow. SEC, what's up, y'all?
I don't know if that's on the list.
I think that's like super on the list. I think that's like top three.
You know, I realize you can say bitch on the radio, but you can't say Zen. Xanax, right? Yeah. I'm like, how, that's some sexism right there. Yeah. Like, it's interesting, right? Okay, anyways. So this guy called me that word. And the other day I was on my bike and he didn't see me. I was riding up behind him and I got real close and I turned around and I looked him in the eye and he jumped a little and I got joy out of that. I did. I also got joy last night doing that on the bike lane and on Roosevelt going to Taste of Chicago to some white people. But anyways, do I get joy from doing it on the intersex perspective?
I think just in general, because you're also a member of, you know, this community of people fighting for all these different forms of liberation, you know?
And that's the other thing. It's not just being my living, anger.
Being a living, breathing threat.
Yeah.
Like your existence as that threat, yeah.
I guess. I want to feel more like a threat soon, which I think is going to happen on Intersex Awareness Day this year, on October 26th. But
shout out October 26th.
Shout out October 26th, Intersex Awareness Day. Please hit me up if you're interested in collaborating.
That early promotion.
Yeah. No, honestly, like last year, I'm like, I'm starting in January. And now it's June and I haven't started. I'm like, okay, I'm in July. I'm like, shit, I can start. But it's not just anger that pushes me forward. It's this community in Chicago. Yeah. Every winter, I'm like, I'm moving to LA. I'm moving somewhere warm since I was like three. I'm like, I'm moving to California. And every year I don't because I love the people here. And I would, because I'm prone to sadness, I would probably get so sad in another city without my community that I just can't even imagine it. So the community here and what goes on in Chicago, which I think I saw Dimris, I think on Twitter recently say, is someone going to come up with a name for this amazing renaissance that's happening right now?
We have a term.
Did you come up with a term this week?
The Chicago Radical Renaissance.
Okay, alliteration. Shout out to Def C.
You don't seem sold. You don't seem sold on our term.
I don't know. Radical's kind of played out.
Yeah,
but
all right, fine.
But like, I think it's also has something to do. It has to, like, I don't know. I don't know what the term should be. But I think there is something special in Chicago. And when I take a picture, say, of an action, which I don't do very often, shout out Sarah G for holding that down always. I'm like, oh my God, this is special. Like, this is going to be in 20 years. Like, I forgot what I was just at. And I was just like, oh, it was Jamila Woods at Double Door. Was it Double Door?
Yeah.
I was just like, were you guys there?
Yeah.
I was not. I was out of town.
It was amazing.
Okay. You felt this magicalness. And I was just like, this documentation of this is not it's not just all going on my Instagram. This is like, oh, this shit's going to be history.
Yeah, I mean, this is why we do this radio show. It's exactly what you're describing.
Right? And it was called Heaven. The night was called Heaven. And it was about cultivating Black joy. And it was just about creating beauty and like and the music and then the youth and the people that came up before Jamila. And
I know this is radio, but there's a great picture from that
event that
Sarah G took of Pidgeon going crazy.
This is why I have that timeline notification thing on my Facebook, so I cannot approve all of her pictures of me because there's something like that where I look like a Muppet in the crowd. Like, but yeah, that's Chicago right now. I'm sorry, New York and LA, but and the Bay, but I'm sorry, but like Chicago is.
Don't be sorry.
It's magical.
Yeah.
It's Chicago. Yeah. It's amazing.
Yeah. And to that point of community, I mean, I think it's something I really actually wanted to ask you about because I think in like mainstream discourse around like gender and sexuality, there's kind of this myth of the queer community as this like singular thing, right?
They do not like me right now.
Right. So I want to talk, a little bit like, you know, in the, man, you're blowing up here.
Man, I got my cousin live with me. He uses my phone. So like, so all day I'm just getting calls and FaceTime requests from like, speaking of community, there's like a community of like 12 to 19 year olds that are just on Facebook all day. And then they like Facebook chat and then they like FaceTime and then my phone is ridiculous right now. Y'all have no idea. He's like breaking up with girls on my phone. So I'm getting like, I'm getting like crazy ass response in my inboxes. I'm like, this has nothing to do with you. But I'm sorry, you were talking about oppression.
I gotta say that for 1 second. Back to oppression. I love the idea that like in the midst of like movement stuff, like your phone has never blown up more.
I'm getting FaceTime requests from like a 17-year-old girl in Centralia, Illinois or something. Who knows? Like who knows?
This is how they bring you down, by the way. This is Anyway, but to that point, the myth of like a monolithic queer community in the city, because the community that you're talking about being that restorative thing that gives you joy and keeps you together here is not that. That is like, you know, rather than me saying it.
So like, it is in a way like the LGBT community or the LGBTQ community is where I first found a sense of home for who I am, like my gender and all that, and my sex and my sexuality and blah blah blah. But I don't have a traditional coming out story. I didn't feel queer growing up or gay. I was attracted to boys and I was assigned female and whatever, whatever. And it wasn't until college that I started dating women and I started identifying as queer. It wasn't until college I heard the word feminism. It wasn't until college I heard the word queer as a good term, you know what I'm saying? So, but it is that community that also embraced me sort of. But then I've always thought about this, thinking about this today. It's also been the non, like, explicitly queer community in Chicago from people, like, from before Cumbia Sasso, we used to throw these parties called, I think, the People's DJ Collective. They're still called that, I think. But they had these parties in their yard in Little Village. And there would be a piñata, and we would be dancing in the yard. And I always, that's where I felt like I could dance for the first time, like, openly and not, like, unabashedly. And that wasn't explicitly a queer community.
Right, that's not Boys Town.
Right, that's not Boys. No, I hate Boys Town. Yeah. I hate Boys Town. And no one has a good time in Boys Town anymore. It's just not, that's not the life. That's not where I want to be. But, and then there's, like, so much organizing in Chicago that's against, say, police brutality or raising up young Black women, say, Asada's daughters or BYP 100, that hasn't explicitly centered on a queer women of color, a queer Black woman ethos. And that's amazing because then you get to, because as my friend Cypher says, he's an intersex trans man from Atlanta. He's from New York, but he lives in Atlanta. He said, we need to start talking about how the liberation struggle for Black liberation and intersex justice and intersex liberation is intermingled because the oppression and the violence by the state is something we're fighting as intersex, as Black folks for him, but also the violence from the medical industrial complex is what intersex people are fighting. And he's Black and intersex and trans, so he's got all that intersecting. And we need to start talking about that. And for me, it's very natural in Chicago to do that because the activist spaces here that aren't explicitly queer are still queer or queer embracing. And more every day, thanks to like trailblazers who are doing that work here in Chicago that I'm indebted to. So that's why I love Chicago. I love Chicago.
A little love letter there. Yeah.
Some things I don't love, as we all know.
You can talk about it. You get to get a few minutes. We
don't love Rahm Emanuel. Yeah. We don't love 12. Right. We don't love the school, what they're doing to the schools, like gutting out the public school system that I'm a product of. We don't love that stuff. We don't love the taste having less food. Like I couldn't even find the lemonade this year. Mm. The lemonade shaker people, they weren't there. But you know that there's the people. Chicago's always been about the people. We're not like the prettiest city, the coolest city, whatever. But we've always had the best people, I think. Mm. And that's showing, I think, in our music scene and our activism scene and just our people. It's a people scene.
So I know some of your work takes you beyond the boundaries of the city and you travel and you do talks and workshops and stuff like that and presentations. Are there like any consistent, you know, responses that started as surprising have now, like basically, what are you getting back that?
Not all doctors. I get that a lot, especially if like it's a kid of a doctor in the audience or whatever. They'll come up to me and they'll be like,
"They're good doctors.
They're good doctors out there." Or, you know, your doctors didn't mean to harm you. That's the number one that I've heard since day one. They didn't mean to hurt you. They were doing what's best for you. No, I don't think a grown man cutting off a baby's clitoris is ever meant to not harm somebody. Like, where in the world is that a good thing? Unless someone wants that. Say it's a cultural thing and they want that. I'm all for that. Do what you need to do. But if it's like on an infant that has no say in this, it's not part of my culture, et cetera, et cetera. No, don't touch me. Don't touch intersex people. Don't touch anybody. So that's a response I get a lot. I even get it from doctors. Sometimes I'll be showing my film. I have a documentary about growing up intersex. And
where can the people see that?
Shout out October 26th, Intersex Awareness Day. I will be probably releasing it then to like YouTube or whatever. But right now I just show it at schools and like functions because it's still a work in progress. It's called The Son I Never Had. Mm. It's like experimental. It's interesting. It's got all audio actually. It was made for the radio in my head. And then it translated with some pictures and video. But it's made to carry its own on the radio because I think it's like the most accessible form of media.
Well, if you ever want to play it up here, you know, we'll give you a slot.
I don't know.
Okay. We'll talk business after.
We'll talk business.
At the Lighthouse, shout out. Our sponsor, 1370. Lighthouse.
Oh, the Lighthouse. Oh, girl, Lighthouse?
It's a restaurant, 53rd. Oh,
yeah.
Don't
they sponsor you?
Yeah. Hey. We'll get you a meal.
I heard they got really good food.
Yeah, if you are anywhere near Hyde Park and you go to Chipotle, you're a lame.
And I really like that place called I'm gonna say the name of like B Gabs or something.
It's Ashworks
there.
I got a green smoothie there this morning.
Yeah.
On my way.
Shout out to the community
in Hyde Park. I love Hyde Park. I live in Pilsen, but second favorite is a tie between Hyde Park and Rogers Park, if Miriam Cobb is listening. Mm. She thinks Rogers Park is the best neighborhood in Chicago. and it's all right, it's good.
But to that hustle and that travel, because I do think like one of the things that I admire about you also is like you're figuring out all these different ways to make a life in this work that's not this like career based.
Thank you for noticing that.
It's hard, right? A lot of it is
learning
like
as I go.
Your merch game is crazy. Your tea game is crazy. And I see them everywhere also.
Really?
So.
You sure it's not just my Twitter feed?
It's like mostly your Twitter feed. But not just your Twitter feed. No, but to that point, like
Wilson's image on, what's it called? AV on Twitter.
But bringing both like the hustle of it and also your, you know, we haven't really even talked about you as an artist.
Here's the thing. I hate nonprofits and I hate that structure.
Yeah.
I didn't know that at first. Yeah. I was like, cool, they're a nonprofit. That sounds dope.
Yeah.
Outside of capitalism. Yeah. Yay. I worked for one. Oh my God. I got on all these pills from my psychiatrist for the first time in my life. I never slept. I was avoiding work. I hated the nonprofit structure. And I read this piece about the revolution will not be funded. And it was like, if the nonprofits were really going to destroy the problem that they were out to destroy, how would they exist? Because if their funding is based on that problem still existing, mm-hmm. how would their salary still come in? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, there's some good people I know who actually do want stuff to end. They're not literally like trying to keep the problem afloat just to get their paycheck. But honestly, on some subconscious level, I think nonprofits do suffer a little bit from that paradox that you only exist because of the problems that exist.
Yeah. And I think on a deeper level, right? Like that is true, but also like kind of inherently cynical, like, right? Like
it's
how can you try
cynical.
To get rid of poverty if your job is to fix, right? Which is very much true. But to that point we were making earlier of like a lot of the problems that we are fixing are kind of created by the intended solutions.
Yeah.
Like the idea of a nonprofit was created out of like the neoliberal, like Nixon, Reagan thrust of like, we as a society will stop funding the things that we need. And what you can do
is
if you're rich, is that you can get
donate your money and get your tax write-off.
Right? And so the idea of that entity to take all of that charity, that is the excuse for our society, our state, right? Like not giving us the services we need is inherently like toxic, even if it's the best non-for-profit, even if it's
right. There's some bomb. Well. Yeah. Thank you so much. There's some good nonprofits out there, but like the other structural problem is some of them dictate what you can do with that grant money,
mm-hmm.
and then you spend a lot of your time writing grant reports, and then you have to stay in, like if it's a governmental bond,
you're running
fund,
around looking for funding.
You're running around, you're competing with others who could be getting the money, so you're fighting for scraps and crumbs. Then a lot of nonprofits like to highlight certain people and say, look at this shining example that made it.
Right, and so then people start, exactly.
And it's like, okay, well, see, it's not that bad.
If you want
to- This guy pulled himself up by his bootstraps or whatever, and that's just not a good model to live by. I don't think. Anyways, I wanted to get out of that world and I didn't know how. So I went into $10,000 of debt this year after I quit my job with the nonprofit world. And I was like, what can I do? And I was like, oh my God, I give these talks, but I never sell anything. I've never sold anything. Yeah. So I was like, maybe I could make a print. I made one print that says Intersex is Beautiful. And then it kind of spiraled out of that because I was so ashamed of being intersex. I was not going to tell anybody for the first 2 years after I found out. I was like, I'm not telling nobody. People think we're hermaphrodites. They make fun of us on TV and movies and whatever. And like, we're monsters. We're monsters in the public eye. And I just felt so ashamed. And, but then I started telling people and people still embraced me and loved me. And that gave me fuel. And then I was thinking like, there's so many movements out there that kind of flip the script and say, you know, like in Chicago, we see "You are beautiful." That's a sticker everywhere. Yeah. But then there's "Trans is beautiful." There's "Black is beautiful." There's so many things that is beautiful now that we're trying to reclaim. And I was like, okay, I'm gonna try to do that with intersex. And then that kind of went into prints, like making these like little artistic prints. And then it became T-shirts. And now that, like, yeah. And by the way, I wanna I don't know if this is possible, but I wanna give away a T-shirt. I brought one. And if, ooh, I don't know how to do this, but yeah, somewhere, yeah, on the Facebooks or something.
Yeah, yeah, I think, yeah, the way to do it, hit us. If you want one of these, which shirt? It's the post-gender shirt?
It's whatever they want. I have two, post-gender or too cute to be binary. And, you know, I can talk to them after about the size, yeah, and their address.
Here, but say a code word right now.
Uh-huh.
And if they tweet us, Facebook, anything AirGo Radio, and they hit us, whatever you say the word is right now, we'll set it up to get it. So if you're listening live at 88.5 WHBK.
Or on the podcast.
Or if you're on the podcast, AirGoRadio.com, SoundCloud, iTunes. We're gonna drop this code word.
Oh, so the other thing, man, you are a marketing genius. Look at this.
All right, the code word is...
We love us.
We love us.
Sorry,
all right. No, that's cool. It's like Echo.
We love us. So the first person to tweet AirGo Radio, we love us, or Facebook AirGo Radio, we love us, you're getting a free T-shirt. Oh, yeah. This is love.
This is a beautiful thing.
This is good radio.
you took us to a whole
I thought of that in
level.
The shower where I get all my thinking done.
That's great.
And if you don't win the shirt, you can go to my social media and find out my Etsy store and get whatever you want.
And we link to it on your AirGo Radio show.
Oh,
page.
Yeah.
It's on there.
The AirGo Radio page got it too.
So one other addition, based off what we were just talking about on the nonprofit end, to the AirGo reading list, and I've been talking about this book forever, there's only one copy of it in the Chicago Public Library system, and I had to return it. So it's available, I think. You can go get it. It's called The Revolution Will Not Be Funded, inside the nonprofit industrial complex. It gives like all kinds of context and info for what we were just talking about. Yeah, we're gonna make a tab. Shout out to our associate producer, who I might give him that job.
This
Chris
station
Cannon
is amazing.
Yeah, we're killing the game. as we get ready to get out of here, first off, thank you so much.
Three
I
minutes.
Know, right?
No music.
Crazy. We'll play it to go on out. But first off, just thank you so much for being here.
Yeah, much love. Yeah.
And this was amazing, and I feel so much better than I did an hour ago.
I was excited. I wanted to learn a lot about you, and I feel like obviously we did that. So
yes.
I'm super excited. I'm glad to go get something to eat at the lighthouse.
Where can the people find
you? That's what I meant to ask.
You, your writing,
give
them
all the social medias and all.
Okay,
the blogs, and we
it's hard because I don't have a consistent one. But Pidgeon on Twitter, but it's twitter.com/Pidgeon, PIDGEJEN.
Okay.
Because I was born as Jen, JEN, and Pidgeon. Oh. Get it?
I did not know.
Oh, yeah, I didn't know either at first for the first few years. And then facebook.com/Pidgeon, PIDGEON. And then you can find my writing. Oh, I got Instagram too. I think it's Pidgeon is my name. And then I'm on Everyday Feminism. You can find my writing there. Or I have a website. That would be easier. Pidgeon is my .name name. Pidgeon is my name.
That's so cool.
Yeah, that's cool, right? It's cool. But it's really hard to explain to people. thank you so much. I've always listened to AirGo, and everyone that's come on before, I was like, oh my God, I love everybody. And when you guys asked me last week, I was so... I don't know the
Thank
word.
You so
honored.
Much
I'm so honored. Thank you so much.
It's an honor to have you. So we're going to get out of here.
And we're going to hear Rick Wilson, right?
Yes, Rick Wilson.
This is new music coming off the new EP that isn't even out yet, y'all. It's going to be called Soul Bounce.
This is
Rick in the building. Shout out, Rick Wilson.
Talk about Black Joy.
What up?
There we go. Thank y'all so much for tuning in. We'll be back next week with another strong young voice. Peace.
Much love.
Check it. Sounds of the kids with the free lunch. Brother of the sister killed by police. Cousin of the cousin in the jail gates. And the owner of the nose that the world hates. And creation of the fried chicken meals. And the sweet, sweet potatoes and the ribs on the grill. Shooting up our cousins and we more when they killed. Then they go try to sue cause we forced them to feel. I'm thinking about Quintonio in Chicago. And all my people who raised base survival. Yay, saying mercy, mercy, Miralago. And I'm just trying to get these racists off our throats. Get them depressed faces off our courts. Cause we ain't come out here to lose here today. Actually, we never gonna lose here again. Smack a bottle to your face, then it's cool with your friend. Cause you was never really down for us. You ain't never give a shout to us. To make a smile for us. Only to ask for and destroy for us. It's about time that we love ourselves and divest your help. Cause you was never really down for us. You ain't never give a shout to us. To make a smile for us. Only to ask for and destroy for us. It's about time that we love ourselves. So everybody say we love us. Everybody left side, right side, hey.
We love us.
left side, right side, everybody love. I see my bros getting locked in Chicago. 16 shots in Chicago. Can't even walk 16 blocks in Chicago. Food that's a corn syrup, I'll be parched in Chicago. Fuck around and probably had to shoot back now. Nothing else will make a cop stop killing us. We gotta love us over all else. And stop expecting white folks to give a fuck. See, I've been thinking for a minute, no bullshit. I got the full clip, not the one you wanna fool with. About to build a nation case the pigs wanna bullshit. Tryna spit that knowledge so my people win on bullshit. Preachers selling out, he telling lies in the pulpit. But I'm offering alternatives, gotta put the work in. Heat to the fires like some furnaces. Do not shoot your brother, that shit purposeless, you feel me? Cause you was never really down for us. You ain't never give a shout to us. To make a smile for us, only the aspirin destroy for us. It's about time that we love ourselves and divest your help. Cause you was never really down for us. You ain't never give a shout to us. To make a smile for us, only the aspirin destroy for us. It's about time that we love ourselves. So everybody say, we love us. Everybody, left side, right side, hey, we love us. Left side, right side, everybody. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to shine the shade they try to give. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to live the life we choose to live. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to shine the shade they try to give. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to live the life we choose to live. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to shine the shade they try to give. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to live the life we choose to live. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to shine the shade they try to give. And as the world turn, we know it's our turn to live the life we choose to live. Cause you was never really down for us. You ain't never give a shout to us. To make a smile for us, only the aspirin destroyed for us. It's about time that we love ourselves and divest your help. Cause you was never really down for us. You ain't never give a shout to us. To make a smile for us, only the aspirin destroyed for us. It's about time that we love ourselves. So everybody say, we love us. Everybody, left side, right side, hey, we love us. Left side, right side, everybody go.